guys. How are you doing?
Good, thank you.
Double timing it today, introducing everyone, and I get to have this conversation with you. So we've spent a lot of time on this stage today talking about how the media landscape is changing, how consumers basically have the pick of the litter in terms of how they're consuming content and making informed decisions. So I'd just love to hear from the both of you, just for starters, what's keeping you up at night?
I'll go first.
Far away.
Thanks, Mark. So what's keeping you up at night? I get that question a lot, and it's not my four kids, because they're a little older now, but thanks for the question. You know, I love this name of this panel this year for Forbes, because a month ago we celebrated our 100th anniversary as a company. So it's good timing to be talking about, you know, keeping a legacy alive and how to build an enduring brand. I will say I'll get to your question in one more second, but when I look back, and I've looked back a lot on the Forbes history, you know, it was started by an immigrant, a Scottish immigrant to America. And BC Forbes had the good foresight in its first issue of the magazine to talk about two things. He had a real famous quote in the first issue that said, the purpose of business is to create happiness, not to pile up millions, right? And I think that's something that stands with us. You know, that purpose stays with Forbes even to today. And the second thing was on the cover, there was a little call out to a big feature story about the upcoming role of women in business. And I love your shirt there today, the future is female. And BC was pointing that out in the inaugural issue of Forbes 3 years before women had the right to vote in America. So when you think about that, you know, that higher purpose and that foresight to take on issues and topics that the future will be challenged with, I think that's good. So to get out of what our history is and into our future, we really still live and abide by those same two things, right? And I think that's been a cornerstone of what Forbes is doing. Now back to your original question of what's keeping us up at night. The business has changed more in the last 5 years at Forbes than it has in the first 95 years to that point. And it's dramatic. And when you think about the way people are consuming information and engaging with information, it's no longer acceptable to have an editorial team that lives in this sort of ivory tower and just broadcasts out to its audiences. So the things that we've done and accomplished and still need to accomplish more of is think through how do we engage with this new entitled audience that has, you know, all the technology in their pocket. They can be media companies, they can create content, they can build an audience, they can distribute content. And it's that, I didn't make this up, but it's that IWW, IWW, IW culture, right? I want what I want, when I want it. I think I did that right. So we really have to reorganize our organization to be able to serve that need. I'm sure we'll talk a little bit more about that in a little bit, but that's not an easy thing to do.
Right, absolutely. Mark, what about you?
Do you know, I find it really interesting. There's loads of parallels between a brand like Forbes and actually a brand like Guinness that I work on. I'm lucky enough to sit in the Guinness Brewery in Dublin, surrounded by cobblestones. It's where Arthur Guinness first set up the brewery in 1759. And all of that kind of history is really present for us. We've got this amazing archivist in my team who kind of is able to repurpose stories from our past to make them relevant for today. And all of that could be really limiting if you allowed yourself to only tell stories about, you know, we're really old. We used to be great once. And actually, what I've learned is, and this still kind of keeps me up at night, is our responsibility is to be inspired by that, to reinvent Guinness for the future. Because that's really what the history of Guinness has been about in the past, of reinventing, doing things differently from everyone else, whether that was choosing to brew black beer when everyone else was brewing ale, or all the kind of science breakthroughs that we've done over the year. And our responsibility now is to make Guinness relevant and the way that we connect with consumers to be relevant in a way that's changing more rapidly than at any time since Guinness first started.
So I'm the VP of Marketing at Stack Overflow, and so the company was founded in 2008, and so my brand that I represent is very new compared to yours. And so one of the challenges I think every marketer brand faces today is how do you produce quality content, how do you do it rapidly, how do you make it resonate, and do it for all sorts of medium as out there. And so I guess tell me about how you approach content strategy and content production in your organizations.
Sure, and I think the first step of that is recognizing how the consumers of this content have changed, right? It's, again, when I said that broadcast model doesn't necessarily work, it's definitely more fragmented. People have unique needs to themselves. And I think our strategy is, how do we create an environment that serves many personas, not, you know, your traditional 10 or 12, but we're talking about hundreds of personas of like-minded people, and try to start communicating with them or engaging with them at scale, but individuals at scale. So that's part of the strategy. The way we do that, again, is thinking of, you know, the world is turned upside down, and if the control is now with the consumers, how do we engage with them? How do we use technology to engage with them? So it's everything from changing our content creation model from a few people with power to finding experts in their fields, and now there's, you know, thousands of content creators who are experts, and they go through the same vetting process as, you know, the Forbes editorial staffers, but we have to look at the samples of their writing, we have to look at their expertise, we have to see how they're engaging with their communities, but then bring them onto Forbes, onto our common CMS or our common platform, so that we can both help them elevate their personal brand, and then also Forbes' brand gets elevated by, you know, thousands of individual brands. So when you do that right over time, and I think the last part of that is, you know, so it's a tech solution, it's a data solution, understanding what consumers are most interested in. And the third part of that is the transparency part, right? How we really want to make sure people understand, you know, basic things about Forbes content now, when it was published, by whom, and really just like a lot of metrics around engagement. So there's things that we make very public on the site, so you see how many views and how many comments and how many shares a piece of content gets, and then we're looking at it on the back end really at a much deeper level with engagement time and you know, just a lot of other metrics. I won't bore you with all the details. But all of that feeds into this personalization engine, again, to recommend more content that is specific to an individual's needs.
And I think at Diageo, we, across all of the Diageo brands, from Guinness to Johnny Walker, we have four things that we try and think about when we build our content strategies that are quite different from what would have been the case 5 years ago. First and foremost is purpose. Tom spoke about purpose at Forbes. And that's our cornerstone of why does this brand exist and how we can communicate our purpose in the most relevant way to consumers. But the second is really different, how we do that in a way that's personal. Personal at scale, and moving from what would typically have been a broadcast model that still plays a really important role as we try to reach as many people as possible, but make sure that we're also connecting up those same themes with ways of having an audience of one, so that we're tailoring those messages digitally to people. The third is then partnerships. I feel like that's the biggest single change over the past few years, that we're not trying to do everything ourselves, that it's about partnering with interesting people, people who are great at making food experiences, interesting people in beer, and telling stories with them instead of perfecting our ads behind closed doors. And then fourthly, about performance, which is really about listening, about not expecting everything to be perfect to start with, but actually trialing, experimenting, and acting on what we see from that, acting on the stuff that doesn't work, and also getting behind the stuff that does work.
Yeah, I love that comment around partnership and experimentation, because, you know, again, if you're talking about building for the future, you don't rest on what you created, but you do have to experiment, you do have to partner. So we're doing a lot of that also, and again, I think if you're really focused on your consumers, and you're listening to them, and you're understanding what they need, it opens up a lot of smart ways to partner and experiment. And I know we were talking backstage about the Forbes Under 30 franchise, which is probably your next question, but I'll jump into it anyway. But that's a franchise for millennials. You know, Forbes is a success brand, and that's really what it's designed to do, provide advice to how to become richer or smarter or be a better business leader or lead a better life, right? That's sort of the core of what Forbes does. And as success, the meaning of success changes, especially with this millennial universe now, who again are thinking through things differently because they have the tools to think things through differently. So we've, about 6 or 7 years ago now, we've launched a new list because we're really good at lists and counting things, but it's called the 30 Under 30 franchise, where we recognize 30 people under the age of 30 in 20 different categories. So business and culture and society who are making a big impact on the world. And I think that, you know, it gives us an opportunity to honor individuals, but it really gives us as much of an opportunity to listen to what is changing the future definitions of success and react to them and drive, you know, different types of businesses forward.
So I see some common themes between what you're saying. There's sort of this need to really listen to your audience, bring more transparency, bring outsiders really into the fold. So I know that change is hard inside organizations, and I'm actually curious, what have been some strategies for you to actually drive different perspectives in your organizations? Because, you know, there's a lot of legacy there, and sometimes you can't teach an old dog new tricks. So yeah. Do you have any advice for those of us who are basically trying to introduce new ways of thinking of the world?
It's really true, and look, we're a big company. And actually, I feel like part of the cultural change we've had to go through is to become small again. And what I mean by that is connecting up, in my case, the brewer with the marketer, with the salesperson, and connecting them up over a beer to understand, you know, what is at the heart of our business once again. Because I feel that distance, whenever marketers are distant from their product, distant from the moment that the consumer is stood there at the bar looking across the different beers on the bar and deciding what to choose, that's where we risk getting separated into our ivory towers. The other thing that I think is really important is a sense of perspective as well. And because the number one thing that we see working in our communications is when we're able to emotionally connect with people. And in particular, if that moment of kind of heightened emotional connection happens in a way that's connected with our brand, that's when our work really works. And that's really important to have that inherent in our ideas. And then we think about, okay, what are the right channels in which we can deliver that emotional moment in the right way? And it can be done really quickly. So one of the brands I work with is Bailey's. Bailey's is just all about pleasure. We've got this amazing number of people who love Bailey's. They just forget to drink it. And our job is to trigger a moment in which to bring that to life. We used to do 90-second TV ads for Bailey's. Now everything we do is to try to be 3 seconds, 15 seconds at most, to just be at somebody's shoulder when they're in the right occasion to say, oh, do you fancy a Bailey's?
So we only have a couple of minutes left, but I do want to ask you, given all of the experience that you have and just sort of what you can see, do you have any predictions for where the world is headed and what lessons would you give yourself if you could go back in time?
Well, I was prepared to, change is hard. I just want to comment on that also. And I know this sounds harsh, but we have a theme or a training method that's change the people or change the people. So we try to change and train on new skills. So that was the one thing. I'm very optimistic about the future. And I think you know, between the tools and the culture, and one of the things, I think the predictions and one of the big initiatives we're doing right now is the next thing, like millennials 7 years ago, we're looking at diversity and inclusion, because the future of business really has to come from people with different mindsets and different practices. So we're doing a big partnership in 2018 with the Idea Initiative. It's a group of technology, advertising, entertainment and media professionals who are really looking to Forbes to pull this through an economic filter for business. So I think it's really optimistic, the future. And I think more of this is going to become of cultural mindsets that's going to affect business. And it makes smart business sense in addition to great social impact.
And I feel for the future, we've spoken a little bit about partnerships and how we're starting to work with other people. I think in a few years' time, we'll look back at now and think, wow, we were still doing all of that stuff on our own. Because I feel like our brands will go more and more into the hands of our consumers. People are really changing the way that they socialize. It's really important for our brands. And more of that power and choice will go into the hands of the consumer. And I think that will put an even higher bar on their expectations of what they expect from brands. Quality, authenticity, storytelling, the bar will get higher and higher.
I feel like I could just pick your brains for hours, but unfortunately we're out of time. Maybe I can grab you for Guinness, you know, later today. But
please do.
Thank you so much for sharing your insights on stage today.
Thank you, Alexa.
Thank you.